Believing it. Bill will believe it.
That submitted it to their name. Anyway, I made one for all the kids and all the grandkids. So if you all want to share these with your friends or neighbors or other relatives, there's no copyright franchise. You'll just have to pay for the copies.
And James, Carolyn didn't send you that part. Blame Carolyn about the cookbook.
Well, I have a cookbook for you.
We don't want to cook anything.
Oh, you do too. Will somebody help me pass them out?
I will.
One. If one.
Hey, do we enter in that?
And everybody give yourself a hand, because I want you to know this is the first time that everybody joined in on the family memory book. They sent their stories to me. I know I was crappy and hateful and email, but we got it done.
I gotta give Melanie a purple.
It'd be my great grandpa Haywood and great grandma Haywood. Their tombstones are falling apart. It's crumbling, they've repaired it, and he would like to see some new ones put on there. And if you would like, give your donations to, am I right, Elaine? Are you taking the money up for the tombstones for the grandparents, Haywood?
No, I'm not.
Well, then I guess we see Uncle Boyce and find out who's going to take care of that. But if you'd like, give some donations to that. It don't hurt to take care of your family. And there's another announcement I'd like to make too. Everybody knows, maybe you don't. Brandy gave birth to a 5-pound,
5 ounce
baby boy named Zachary Friday night.
Thursday night.
And is there anything else anybody wants to announce at this time? If not, we'll go forward.
And the biggest pleasure of all was that when I received information from Uncle Jake about Grandma and Grandpa, I sat down and I read it that night, and I cried, and I laughed. And the reunions, I thought, gosh, this is so boring. But when you get older, it means more. It means a lot to me. There's so much history in here that is so unreal, that you can pass on to your children and their grandchildren. And it means a lot. Believe me, I know, being the oldest grandchild. So, at this time, in front of it says, Haywood Memories, October 13, 2002. As the sun goes down, we remember. And I'd like to read it at this time. This book of memories. I'll pass them out in a minute. I just want to read this. This is something I contributed to. This book of memories is dedicated to you, Uncle Hewitt, for all of the memories you have made with us all. Next, Susan wrote a poem about what family is. Susan,
family. There's a special kind of closeness that only families know. It begins with childhood trust and deepens as you grow. There's a special kind of happiness that sharing little things like laughter, smiles, and quiet talks that daily living brings. There's a special kind of comfort in knowing your family is there to back you up, to cheer you up, to understand and care. Of all the treasures life has to bring, your family means the most, and whether you're near or far apart, that love will hold you close.
To hear his voice and see his smiles, just to sit and talk a while. So you who have a dad, cherish him with care. You will never know the heartache until you see if he can share.
Now, at this time, we'll pass the books out. And if anybody would like to read what they wrote and contribute, feel free to come forward and read it. You don't have to. If you would like to do that, that's fine. I've had the pleasure of reading mine. It's very, very good.
Are you going to read yours?
We did not grow up together, but we are close. Travis came to live with me when he was just a teenager. We've done a lot of things together which made us very close, like brothers and sisters should be. It's never too late to take the time to learn about things about your family or the stories they have to tell. I graduated from Piggott High School in May of 1974. I married Neil Watson on June 14, 1974. While married to Neil, we moved to St. Louis in 1979. After being in St. Louis for 1 year, I went to work at a company named Spicecraft. This was the first job I ever had. In 1984, Neil and I divorced. Uncle Hub and Mike moved me in with a friend of mine, Ella Patterson. She has become a part of my family and I hers. Most people other than family think we're real sisters. In 1988, Spicecraft was bought by a company called Newlywed Foods out of Chicago. Then in 1989, Newlywed Foods moved to the St. Louis location to Gerald, Missouri. Ella and I moved to Washington, Missouri, which was 25 miles from Gerald. In March 1997, we moved to Yorkville, Illinois, where Newlywed Foods bought the F.W. Witt Company. I was the first woman in the company to hold the title of supervisor, quality assurance. I am a member of the Order of the Eastern Star in the Piggott chapter in Piggott, Arkansas. I don't remember having pets as a child, but I was told I had plenty. I had a Pomeranian named Wendy when I first moved to St. Louis. She lived for 5 years, then fell down the steps and broke her little neck. I then bought a Yorkshire Terrier named Mindy. We had her for almost 15 years, and she was the kid that I never had. I don't have talents. I seem to have been left out. I love working outside in the yard, and I also like to strip old furniture. Seems like I learned some of these things from Uncle Paul. I played softball when I was younger. After I moved to St. Louis, I also played softball on the same team as Teresa, but of course, I was the better player.
How many left-handed third basemen do you know?
That's a matter of opinion, isn't it?
There are so many memories of Grandma. She has helped shape my life in so many ways. I remember that she did not believe in sleeping late. She called you one time and you better get up then. She said that all things have their place, so put them there. She said, do it right the first time, and you won't have to redo it. She made me do things outside work, such as mowing and trimming the lawn, pulling weeds out of her flowers, and working in the garden. Boy, did I hate to do this. Now each year, as I plant my own garden and work in the yard, I see her smiling down upon me with a little laugh, saying, I thought you didn't like to do those things. I didn't realize at the time that what she taught me would help me in my future job. Our company motto is do it right the first time and whatever it takes. I was preparing for my job and didn't know it, and I owe it all to her. Being the first grandchild, some people say that I was spoiled. I guess you could say that I was. I had 16 aunts and uncles that made sure of that. There are so many memories that a book couldn't be written, but I am not a writer. I've had a lot of fun with all my cousins. I remember going to the World Series with Mike and Jerry. Teresa and I played on the same softball team together. Susan and John always come to visit with Ella and myself during the summer before they were married. I always knew when Uncle Sonny and Aunt Ella Jean were coming home. Grandma always made me say, Aunt Uncle. Sometimes you very rarely hear that nowadays. The house had to be just perfect, and she prepared special meals for them. I also thought, Uncle Sonny, that you were so handsome. To me, you were like Red Butler.
Oh, Lord!
You were like Red Butler. And Gone with the Wind.
Burt Reynolds.
And Ella Jean. You always gave me a big hug and a kiss. Haywood very rarely did this, and this made me feel very special. Sue and I grew up together. When I learned to write my name, I taught Sue to write her name. I also taught her how to count her money, but boy, was I wrong. I should not cheat her out of a nickel. If I did, she'd always pinch me. Boy, did it hurt. Aunt Elaine and Uncle Hub were home for vacation. Grandma and Aunt Elaine were talking about this guy looking in the windows. I was preparing to take a bath when I heard something scratch on the window. I ran out of the bathroom without clothes on, and Uncle Hub came running out of the bedroom. What is wrong? I told him, and he ran outside to catch the person, and there was no one. Aunt Elaine, in the meantime, had came back in the front room laughing. She had done it. Uncle Hub said he would have beaten her if he caught her, and he didn't think it was funny. And boy, was I scared when my nose started to bleed. I remember all the Barbie doll clothes you made me, Teresa.
You bought us matching clothes, a pink and white plaid cargo. I guess you thought we was twins. That's better looking. Uncle Gerald bought me a bicycle when they lived in Hazelwood. I think everyone helped pay for it, but I'm not sure. One thing I am sure of, that was Betsy Ross' bicycle. I thought that is why he bought it, because it had his name on it. Aunt Wilma, I remember the black and white teddy bear he bought me for Christmas.
Thank you. I got four of them.
I love to spend time at your house and pop a block. Jerry and I were playing the old barn with the poles. Uncle Bill, I remember always hearing you sing the song, Wow. Now, whenever I hear the song on the radio, I think of you. When I see watermelon fields, I think of you, Aunt Carol. You taught me how to steal them.
And she's still feeding today.
I also remember trying to ride your white horse in the bicycle parade, but the noise scared the horse. Uncle Hewlin, you told Aunt Dana that if I would mow your yard, you would buy me a ball glove. Well, I mowed part of the yard, and then I went downtown to get my glove. I bought the best the store had. I still have the glove today. Aunt Dana, you have always been there for me, no matter what. You taught me to be happy with myself. You helped me through high school. You have and will always be my role model in life. I've always had plenty of clothes, and I need to make sure of that. I remember one outfit you made. It was a peach-colored skirt and a peach and white plaid vest that you made me for Easter. Uncle Roger, I remember that you taught me how to drive. We drove your truck. You said that you could teach me how to drive a stick shift. Boy, was you wrong. I still can't drive a stick shift. Liz, you took my Uncle Paul.
Where'd he go?
I would do anything to make him happy, so I guess you're a keeper. I remember you guys coming every Friday night after work. Brush my hair off. Uncle Paul, I was so thrilled that you walked me down the aisle when I got married. You asked me why I was shaking, but you were also shaking. I have learned a lot from you and Aunt Liz about working in the yard and stretching furniture. I remember Uncle James and Aunt Green coming to visit. This was always a good time because everyone was at Grandma's. He always gave me silver dollars, and I still have them today. As I've grown older, I have learned to appreciate the reason for family reunions because of you. I remember Uncle Boyce and Aunt Barbara coming to visit every 4th of July at Uncle Hewlin's house. Everyone was there, and Uncle Hewlin always barbecued and made homemade ice cream. Uncle Roger usually helped do the ice cream. The most important memory I have is when all my aunts and uncles were there when I needed them the most. This was when I had breast cancer. I remember Uncle Hewlin. I remember him holding me in our kitchen and telling me everything's going to be all right. And he was right. I came through it just fine. I hope to be there for you guys someday. I may not say it very often, but I love all you with all my heart. If anybody else would like to read theirs, they can come up with the unique traits of which is to become a true man. Number one, have a flat butt. However, as you can see, that's one trait she'll never have. Be able to give those famous Haywood looks. All of you have seen this look at one time or another. Is that right, Carol? You give those looks, don't you?
All the time.
Be extremely talkative. I have noticed that a few Haywood family members are able to start a conversation, get interrupted for 15 to 20 minutes,
then go back to the same sentence and that same conversation and continue where it left off. Very unique and characteristic, don't you think, Elaine? You have to love homemade ice cream and those famous Haywood cookies. Be a terrific cook. All Haywood ladies are great cooks except for Brenda, she can't boil water. They're also famous for their great desserts. They're right in one. Be able to snore so loud that the neighbors can hear you. Another thing about the Haywoods, they worry about what their yards look like and realize no one can do the yard except him or her. Perfection all the way. That's you,
Paul.
And
that's
last,
you, Brenda.
And last of all, you have to have short, stubby fingers and wide feet.
Thumbs.
The most visible aspect of the Haywoods.
No, that's the first thing I looked at, Zachary's
thumb. And then she says, all joking aside, I have learned so much from this family. I have come to realize that they are not only related, but are also great friends to one another. I guess this is why Brenda and I have become so close. She is one of my three sisters. She comes from a great family who would do anything for each other. I appreciate letting me be a part of this unique and wonderful group of people. I know I will forever be grateful. Thanks to all of you, and I love you all the same as my own family. I want to say one more thing and then I'm done. When I was doing these books at work, I shared with the people that I worked with. And one of my best friends at work, he says, you know, I have two sisters I hadn't seen for 2 years. I don't remember my grandfather. And we don't have a big family. And he says, what you have, you don't realize what you have and what you have here. You should cherish it. You know, if you can fight among yourselves and everything, but we don't let outsiders come in and do it. And if you're going to talk about somebody, better be there, it might be about you, right? That's just the way we all
are. Margie's going to read hers.
It don't bother me one way or the other.
My name is Norma Jean Anderson Salisbury. I was born September 24, 1966 in Little Rock at University Medical Center. My parents are Norman Anderson and Alma Haywood Anderson. Mama wasn't happy about having another kid. It was too soon after Dulcie. When I was 4 years old, Mom and Daddy thought something was wrong with my eyes, so I went to the Arkansas School for the Blind until the third grade. From there, I went to public school. I have two sisters and two brothers. They're Linda Sue, Dodra Marie, Travis Neal, and David Richard. So this means I have a middle child. It's not easy. My first husband was Victor Burdett. We had three children, Victoria Autumn, born September 24, 1983, Nicole Michelle, born July 23, 1985, Victor Burdett, the third, born October 1st, 1987. We were divorced November of 1991. From there, I met my current husband, John Salisbury, who is the love of my life. We got married April 21st, 1995. With this, I gained another daughter, Tanya Lynn. I have two beautiful grandchildren, Michael Derrick, born June 21st, 2000. Alyssa Love, my little pole dancer, born August 19th, 2001. I'm such an animal lover that I would bring in every stray if John would let me, but he said the house is full enough. I have a toy Shih Tzu, his name is Dusty, he's 4 years old, 11 pounds. I also have a St. Bernard that he was 11 months and 175 pounds. His name is Diesel. I have a cat, he is 3 years old and 14 pounds. His name is Butch. And last but not least, we have a hamster, his name is Booger. I had numerous vocational classes in banking operations, classes that were taken in Arkansas and Minnesota. John has an MBA management, Bachelor of Science Administration, and an MCSE, Microsoft Systems and Engineering Networking, whatever. Two of my fondest memories was taking the Trailways bus to Gordy and Uncle Paul picking us up at the bus station. Uncle Paul picking us up and taking us to Piggott to Grandma's house. Or Uncle Gerald driving to Little Rock and picking us up and taking us to Grandma's. Grandma was always waiting at the door and Sue was sitting on the porch. We always got to Grandma's house on Friday and everyone would come over to dinner, and Fridays was hamburger night. And boy, they tasted great.
She didn't like them.
I didn't at all.
You're the only one here.
But there's one thing that sticks in my mind, and that was Aunt Carolyn. Would always get yelled at by Grandma because she would touch the food and lick her fingers. And Grandma would call her finger licker. Let's not forget about how Grandma would make everybody be quiet when General Hospital came on. This was her favorite soap opera. While watching the TV, she would sit and paint her fingernails bright red. All of us kids would go and spend the night with Aunt Carolyn and Uncle Bill, Aunt Wilma and Uncle Gerald. All the aunts and uncles would give me a hug. They always made me feel welcome. I never will forget it. Let's not forget about Aunt Sue. Every night, we would have popcorn, and this was a big treat for me. Aunt Sue would eat a Three Musketeers candy bar.
Anybody else?
I'm going to read, because Sue didn't cook very much, and she can't cook now. And I was asking Brenda if she remembered what Sue made, and she didn't. But when we were living in St. Louis and came home for the weekends, it was Sue's job to make the tea, always. And so I'm going to read Sue's recipe for making tea, and then I'm going to read one more recipe that's kind of a funny story. How to Make Iced Tea by Sue Haywood. So now you listen to this and see if you remember, okay? This story is from when we all used to live out on the farm, or we're still living at home with Mother down on Taylor Street. It was Sue's job a lot of times to make the tea for dinner and supper. First, she would run water into a medium-sized pan, or skewer, as Grandma Haywood would call it. The water would come to a boil, and then she would add tea bags, and sometimes loose tea. Next came the magic part. You would let the tea set for a while, or steep, as the recipe books call it. While the tea was cooling, or steeping, or whatever, Sue would fill the pitcher up to about 3/4 full, a large plastic tea pitcher, which had to be washed, but you couldn't dry it because it got lint inside. Grandma Ivy would never let you dry the tea. Then she would put about 14 or 18, you had to be very specific, saccharin tablets in it and let them melt while you were continuing to do your daily tasks. When the tea was cool enough, you would pour it into the sweetened water and stir. You put ice in the glasses and fill it with sweet tea. This was as good as any soda we ever had, and it served for dinner and supper, as Grandma Hay would call it. And so you need a hand for making the tea. And then I'm going to read another recipe that most of you all know. And I probably can't get through this, but I'll try. This is called the 4th of July Chicken Dinner. First of all, you need 50 cases of chicken. We usually buy it at Country Mart. 20 pounds of flour, salt and pepper, 10 gallons of rice oil. That's not 10 little containers like we buy at the store. That's 10 gallons. It has to be hauled in a pickup truck. You wash the chicken pieces and let them drain. Barbara, Diane, and Liz usually do the flouring of the chicken. But lay it out on the frying grills while the oil gets hot. Roger, Paul, and boys cook the chicken until it is done, all the time checking to make sure it is not too brown.
and at the same time continuing to wipe the sweat as it rolls off their faces. While the chicken is cooking, Diane and John empty up huge cans of corn and green beans and add butter while they are cooking. Elaine and Anna are slicing cucumbers and slicing tomatoes, great mounds of cucumbers to be marinated in vinegar, salt, and sugar. Gerald is now helping Mrs. McCrillis cut up and wash more chicken. Things are moving pretty fast. Wilma and Barbara, with some help of other nine Haywoods, slice the pies and cakes for the dessert counter. Dana makes tea in a 20-gallon crock and then adds four bags of ice to begin the chilling process. Now John and Dinah are heating the water with butter to make the cream potatoes, and Elaine starts to make her gravy. That's her job. She don't let anybody else do it. As this is going on, some of the Haywoods are setting up the crocks to serve the vegetables and putting out cucumber, sliced tomatoes, and coleslaw. It's almost 11 o'clock on the 4th of July. The front door to the dining room is open, and the crowd comes in. There are several Haywoods with few other helpers serving up the main menu. Rocky fills up the glasses with ice and Susan pours the tea. He, Kayla, and Amanda watch the tables and remove the dishes and plates and keep the trash carried out. This is a family effort. This year, Debbie and Andy help wash the dishes and the silverware. But that's my sister-in-law and her son. During the years, we have had the help of most of you Haywoods. Some of you weren't named by name because you don't have a specific job, but all of you have been there. This started in 1996 when Hewlin offered for the Haywood family to do this as a project in remembrance of some of our family members. We did not know. They chose one short month after we cooked in 2001. He would no longer be here. For those of you who have not had the opportunity to help with us or work, you have missed a great country meal, plus you have missed a lot of family fun. We know that this was a happy day, not just a hot and sweaty one when we got tired. We usually serve 600 to 700 people on that day, and we know it must be good because the same people keep coming back each year.
Well, then I want to know something. Why did you take something?
Then I had to say about a criminal pot.
What'd you get? What'd you get? A base?
I didn't get nothing. I cheated down. Somebody lives here with weeds higher than that.
Well, there's a VCR there, wasn't there? Gonna sit and tell little Zachary that you're a thief.
Yeah. Some water? On the tricycle, he's gonna ride.
Yeah, he's gonna be riding
those. The tricycle was stolen in the dumpster.
She ran up to her a while ago, and I picked her up, and she gave Sue a kiss.
Thank you. I don't check it a whole lot in December time, but I you know, spend some time on the winter.